celebrating Peter's 67th Earth Strong right here at UWI, University of the West Indies, Mona Campus, Jamaica. I'm glad for those of you who have turned up to take in this program. We do this because we feel that Peter Tosh deserves this. He deserves his just due. And right now I'm going to introduce a speaker who has been responsible for the programming of many of the Peter Tosh symposiums that have been taking place here. And I essentially elected to do the work in the coordination of this event so that our esteemed speaker would have the time to do his necessary administrative and professorial duties. Well, he's a colleague of mine for many years who I admire for his work ethic and for his dedication to many tasks at hand that face us, not only as lecturers and professors and educators, but also as citizens of this country of Jamaica in trying to make an impact and improve the society for the better. Dr. Clinton Hutton is a senior lecturer in the Department of Government. He has published many articles on numerous areas, one on the Haitian Revolution. He's also written on black nationalism and black consciousness and the Rastafari movement. And he also has in the works an anthology on Peter Tosh. So without much further ado, it gives me great pleasure to welcome my colleague, an esteemed lecturer here at UWI, Department of Government, Dr. Clinton Hutton. Let's give it up for Dr. Clinton Hutton.
Hi, brothers and sisters. Good evening. I am going to, this evening, look at Peter Tosh's critique of the philosophy of education. Two songs. One, can't blame the youth, and two, 400 years. But I need to say that there is a tradition in Jamaican popular music that emerged, a tradition emerging in the 1960s, and even before that, a tradition of critiquing the type of existing education, formal education, and even in songs that don't have lyrical content, you have a critique of a type of system and a way of existing, which is problematic for many Jamaicans. In particular, people of African descent. And Peter Tosh's critique of the education system is following a tradition, and probably the most important person in that tradition is Marcus Garvey. Garvey, one, is self-educating. It's the first thing. Secondly, as a self-educating man, he developed a way of dealing intellectually with society, which I call the sovereign learner, the person who is able to teach himself to learn. Indeed, it is my opinion that the most important goal of education, here and wherever else, is to allow students to develop their capacity for self-education. To allow students to become sovereign learners. To allow students to teach themselves to learn. Because if we don't do that, I mean, most of the things that I know I didn't learn here, and most of the things that anyone will ever learn, they will have to learn on their own. And therefore, to be a sovereign learner, it means that as long as you have life, you should be seeking about your education. And the way you do it, most of the time, is by educating yourself. And especially for people of African descent, they can ill afford not to be sovereign learners. Because many of the things that they will learn about themselves, they will not learn it in the formal education system. They'll have to do it on their own. Garvey said, the West Indian Negro, of course, I wouldn't use that word. I don't think he probably used that today. The West Indian Negro does not rely much on his mind. He seems to give way to his misfortunes, his history of enslavement and colonialism. Those misfortunes will not help him except he uses them as a conscious realization of the advantages taken of him. Because he cannot climb by his own present state of mind. Peter Tosh's criticism of the education system is in this tradition. Is in this tradition. Can't blame the youth, and I'm going to touch on them, and 400 years. And of course, that tradition is also seen in Marley's song. That tradition is also seen in songs by a group called the Itals, and other groups as well. Let us look about this issue of state of mind, whether you can climb by your own state of mind. Because it is a belief that a particular type of education, what a person is largely as a result of his socialization, of his education. And insofar as black people feel a certain way about themselves, they will act in a certain way. Usually not in their self-interest. So for Tosh, the education system, as far as he's concerned, must assist the youth to invent new eyes with which to see. Because the eyes that they have inherited will not allow them to see beyond a certain boundary. The eyes planted in the youth by colonialism, by over, in some cases, over 350 years of enslavement. In the case of Jamaica, 329 years of enslavement. That the eyes planted in the youth cannot allow him to see a sovereign path or to vision and to imagine himself in a way in which he is a sovereign human being. And in this sense, mathematics cannot allow, being educated mathematically will not allow you to see yourself in that path. Neither if you are educated scientifically. And in the way we do history traditionally, or accounting education, those forms of education and the subject matter dealt with in those forms of education are very, very important. I cannot stress that. But there is another kind of education that is required for self-emancipation. So, for example, I would argue that Justina, the 19th century Jamaican woman who said, quote, "I never could love a black child the same as the white. I worship the little master, and if I lucky, even I may have a fair child one day. Not, of course, a real white one." That's asking too much. But still, one that is almost white. "And then I worship it and work for it for true. Dress it up nicely too, in clean white clothes, with shoes and all, just like a Bakra baby. I hope I never have a black or dark child to shame me." The education that she needs is not just an education in math. In fact, math education can't solve the problem that she has. Education in the sciences cannot solve the problem that she has. She requires another kind of education. And I am suggesting to you, is this other type of education that is largely missing from the educational system? And is this type of education that Peter Tosh would wish to see in the education system? It is the same thing. Those counselors in St. Elizabeth in 2006 voted not to commemorate the 200th anniversary of the end of the British trafficking of Africans. They voted not to commemorate that event, or the set of events that year, that would come the year after, 2007, because they argue that it will instill shame in our children, in our students. Learning about the end of, or the abolition of, the trafficking of Africans, and learning about slavery will instill, they argue, shame in young people. And yet, before there was ever that commemoration, before that, we were hit with the epidemic of bleaching. Before that, we were hit with the constant telling, especially men telling women, "You know you look good for a black girl." Never hear the concept that you look good for a white girl, or you look good for a brown girl. You look good for a black girl. As if both can't be in the same sentence. This is a kind of education. A kind of education that maths can't deal with. A kind of education that accounting cannot deal with. And this is this type of education system that Peter Tosh criticized. Or take the case of Mark Digwall, who wrote in The Gleaner, 2007, "We black were changed for the better on account of slavery. We are a better race today because our ancestors went through slavery. The millions of lives lost were not lost in vain. The Europeans proclaimed the need for us to be civilized through slavery. And though this might be hard to understand, they were right. Indeed, based on what is happening in black Africa today, slavery for us in the West, in many respects, was our salvation." And from time to time, daily, you see things like this. Whether they are educated formally or informally, we see things like this. Whether we teach about slavery or not, we see things like this. Right? The person who is raped is not the one who should be ashamed. It's the rapist who should be ashamed. And so, when we look at two songs by Tosh, Can't Blame the Youth, and let us look at it. This one. It says in part, you teach the youth about Christopher Columbus, and you said he was a very great man. You teach the youth about Marco Polo, and you said he was a very great man. You teach the youth about the pirate Hawkins, and you said he was a very great man. You teach the youth about the pirate Morgan, and you said he was a very great man. All these great men were doing robbing, raping, killing, and kidnapping and killing. So-called great men were doing robbing, raping, kidnapping. So you can't blame the youth. You can't fool the youth. In fact, he said, you can't blame the youth when them don't learn. In fact, suggesting that a type of education that they get, in fact, in some instances, turn off young people. That the way they are educated and the type of education they get turn off some people. Or turn them off because they don't like the subject matter, or because they felt that that type of education is not in their best interest. Before talking about Columbus and Hawkins and Morgan, he said, you teach a youth to learn in school that the cow jump over moon. You teach a youth to learn in school that the dish run away with the spoon. All right, so here we see a critique of education that looks at it in two ways. One, about the cow jump over the moon and the dish run away with the spoon, as saying, okay, this is for black people. This is what they deserve. This is the type of nonsensical stuff that they deserve. That is the one way in which he looked at it. The other way is to teach about conquistadors, pirates, colonialists, as if they are great people. And therefore, when the youths see these things and pick up the gun, because he linked it with the violence in the country at the time, he linked it with the violence amongst youth in the country. What is that? Yeah, he linked the thing with violence and saying that if you are teaching the youths all of these things, why are you quarreling with them when they take up the gun? If pirates are a good role model, why are you so hurt when young people take up the gun? Right? So that he links education, the type of education, with what young people do. That the type of education that they get shape their agency, shape their sense of self, and part of shaping this sense of self is shaping what they want to become. Marley, in a song called Music Lesson, pretty much said the same thing. In this song, Marley sings, music gonna teach them one lesson. Music gonna teach them one lesson. Music gonna teach them one lesson. Teach them about Marco Polo. Teach the good youth Christopher Columbus, how these wicked men rob, cheat, kill the poor in defense of this land. Heard they are from this far land. The color of our skin made us understand. Why is this teaching Marco Polo? Couldn't it be one of them great Africans? I am suggesting that this is the type of education that would make a difference. This type of education, which is largely absent from our school, in its philosophical sense, is a problem. It's a problem today. And it is the same problem which the Itals in the 1970s did a song called Inna This Ya Time. And in this song, the Itals argue that man, in fact, warn, really arguing, warn that man of a mind him get carried away by captivity. Captivity is a symbol of enslavement. Man of a mind him get carried away by captivity. Right? So here again he's linking with the ways a person is socialized through education and other means, and what that socialization mean for those persons and what they mean for the country. Right? So, in this your time, man, you have a mind, you get carried away by captivity. Carried away by captivity. How you are going to say that you love Jaja, yet you are fight tribal against your brother, in this your time? Now, these men who wrote and sung these songs, have, in fact, profoundly critiqued this type of education system. It's a profound critique of it. That the philosophy of education is depriving students, young people, in one sense, that while it's good, and I'm putting words in their mouth now, why it is good to do everything else, and in fact, it's imperative to do everything else. It's imperative to do the maths and become great mathematicians and great scientists. Indeed, some of the best and most fundamental inventions in the world, used all across the world today, are invented by people of African ancestry, including the PC. But even in the context of this kind of education, much people don't know about it. Even with the facility to go online. So, in the abundance of water, as one singer would say, the fool is thirsty. That we need the education that we do, what we call the subjects. But there are unmentioned subjects that we need to educate our people in, so that they can know themselves. So that they are not confused in this world. So they do not continue to carry out rituals which desecrate the black body. That one of the things that we need to be most concerned about is agency. The ability of people to make things happen as sovereign beings. and education, the way we think, the way we know, the way we construct meanings, which in philosophy is called epistemology, that the way we do those things shaped our identity and shape our ability to make things happen or how things happen. And therefore, the critique of the education system is very important, and we should take it seriously. In fact, in one of these songs, Marley said, with some justification, not to pinpoint any, because you can't do that, and it's out of frustration as well, when he talks about the church and the university. Graduating thieves and murderers. Or Tosh, when he talks about 400 years, and it is the same philosophy. 400 years, and it's the same philosophy. And the fact is, we have a history of another philosophy, a liberating philosophy, a subordinate philosophy. But it is time we liberate that philosophy. Thank you.
Well, we are now going into our next panelist, and I'm very glad that he could take the time out to make this symposium, and I'm talking about none other than our opposition Minister of Finance, Dr. Omar Davis. Transport, yes, sorry, my mistake. I'm still, all right. Anyway, Dr. Omar Davis is an ardent and vocal admirer of Peter Tosh, Tosh's music. He's written a number of articles in the Jamaican press advocating for greater recognition for Peter Tosh's unique achievements. Over the past few years, Dr. Omar Davis has also extended his support to the Peter Tosh family and also to any endeavors to memorialize and honor this great reggae legend. Dr. Omar Davis has followed the general career of the Wailers in general, but has made it a point to give Peter his just due. And in this, we are both on one accord, I must say, that Peter Tosh has not gotten his just due here in Jamaica, despite his undoubtable and immense contributions to not only the Jamaican reggae industry, but the international music industry. So I must concur with Dr. Omar Davis on this. So without further ado, I'd like us to give a Yui welcome to Dr. Omar Davis. Give thanks.
Thank you, Michael. Good evening, everybody. Well, I think this is, there's an examination going next door. I don't know whether some of our potential audience are there, but for those who are here, let me welcome you and indicate how much of a pleasure it is for me to be here. And let me congratulate Clinton, not just on his discipline, but as his very focused presentation. Clinton, I have always, as a polytechnic politician, technocrat, or academic, I have always loved that line from Marley, because politicians get beat up so much that I was struck when he spoke to the theologians and the academicians. And I'm glad you quoted it. I intended to quote it, so I won't go back there. Let me congratulate Michael Barnett on this effort. It's always a difficult task to mobilize an interest in a topic which has been visited before. But let me indicate to him that I commend his efforts, and I'll tell you why I participate. I participate for several reasons. One is that despite all our challenges, perhaps one of the strongest aspects of Jamaica is the culture, and within the cultural sphere, the music. And it's amazing to me that so many of our musicians, not just the Wailers, not just Peter, just do not receive even a percentage of the acknowledgement which they should. But worse yet, in several instances, when their contribution is recognized, it is indeed tragic that persons, that foreigners, and there's nothing wrong with foreigners recognizing, but it is tragic that foreigners seem to have done more work and certainly put this work down formally, whereby they seem to have carried an appreciation of our culture much further than we have. And it's one of the reasons I keep participating. I think of not just Tosh, not just Marley, not just Bonnie Whaler. And by the way, we need to do some more work on Bonnie Whaler's contribution. But Bob Andy, for example, Bob Andy's compositions, I've got to go back home to experience. Got to tell you goodbye, babe. But there are so many different compositions, and we have not recognized the extent of the width and the breadth of his contribution, and the extent to which he has influenced our lives. And so I participate in these fora because I think there has to be sustained effort in awakening our consciousness as to what these artists were able to perceive so long ago, way before those of us who have had the benefit of whatever higher levels of education understood it. And I'm going to come back to one particular aspect of Tosh's music, which fits within the theme of this symposium, Peter Tosh, activist, protagonist, and musical genius. I'll say one other thing in passing, which I'm surprised that our media houses will give a lot of prominence to all sort of frivolous things. Who is bleaching, who is saying the most inane things. But there's an interesting thing which I stumbled on, the actor Richard Gere. I've shared it with some friends. The actor Richard Gere had been collecting guitars, and amongst the collection was one by Peter Tosh. And he decided to auction the whole set of guitars and give the money to charity. He garnered $1 million from the auction. But the guitar which fetched the highest price in the auction, $98,000, was that of Peter Tosh. I've not seen a word of that in the media, and we see who is outstripping whom and what have you. And it just struck me that it is amazing to me that no one had seen that and said, here is, I didn't know that Richard Gere would be aware of Peter Tosh. And here he had collected his guitar, and this has fetched the highest price in the auction. In speaking about Peter Tosh, the activist, the protagonist, and the musical genius, let me briefly say something about Peter Tosh, the musician. If you speak with those who played with him, they in a sense regard him as a player of instrument who also sang. When he was killed, they did an interview with Jimmy Cliff, and I found interesting that Cliff's tribute to Tosh spoke to the fact that if ever you were doing a recording session and some musician didn't turn up, regardless of the instrument, you call Tosh. He said he would arrive expressing himself as only he could. But he would, after a couple of run-throughs, he would be ready for the recording because he was that versatile a musician. And Alan Skillcole told me, who knew him very well, Cole was an intimate friend of Marley, more Marley than Tosh, but said the only instrument he had never seen Tosh play was the trombone. And this is something which is not appreciated. There is an album by the jazz guitarist Eric Gale called Negril. And Tosh played guitar on that album just as a musician. And you don't get to play with Eric Gale unless you are regarded as a top musician. So I've just put that in context in terms of Tosh the musician. Well, let me say something about Tosh the activist and protagonist. And Clinton has cited two songs, specifically Can't Blame the Youth. He didn't get around much to the second song, but that point is taken. But Tosh, a lot of Tosh's songs, although he had some love songs, much of his work was in social commentary. Naturally, you have to start with Can't Blame the Youth, 400 Years, Stop That Train. Glass House and Peace Treaty was about the peace treaty, which didn't last long, and he prophesied that it wouldn't. Mark of the Beast, Don't Press a Man, which was his adaptation of the Negro spiritual Cinnamon, and we can go through several and a couple of them which made me uncomfortable when I was Minister of Finance. The Day the Dollar Died. Audley's working hard at that. Crystal Ball. Looking at your crystal ball. I mean, they're, what amazed me about, not just Tosh, but these artists, is how they could take a very complex issue, get to the core, drill immediately to the core, and express it in a way which immediately everyone could understand. So there was this history of concern about social issues. And I would like to draw a parallel, because naturally he started with local issues. He started with the education system. He started with the suffering of the those at the bottom of the socioeconomic ladder. He spoke about the injustice, Mark of the Beast. He's a remarkable play on words, you know. They want him for ganja, but how can one man ganja? You know, I said, how come I never thought of something like that? But there's an interesting parallel. And if I take you back some years, people will recall when Martin Luther King had established himself in terms of the civil rights movement and the concern about greater equality, if not equality, for people of color in the U.S. And when he decided to step into the issue of the Vietnam War and took a position on the Vietnam War, there are many within the civil rights movement who felt that this was beyond his frame of reference, and he should have stuck to the basic issue of civil rights. And he was at pains to explain to him that you can't localize the fight for greater equality. And he didn't carry all of his lieutenants with him, but it was his position was on record. Similarly, when Malcolm X stepped out of the shadows of Elijah Muhammad and then started traveling, And this is not a comment on the black Muslim movement, but he felt that he could no longer be restricted to concerns just about the black Muslim movement. And he wished to go into a broader context. In the same way, I would argue that Tosh, building on his initial concern about social injustices at home, realized that this concern cannot be as restricted to Jamaica. And this is a personal view, but I wish I could get to the stage of saying that I have canvassed and I know this to be true. But I consider the album, CD, whatever you call it now, Equal Rights, to be perhaps the strongest single CD built around a theme, the theme of Pan-Africanism and the anti-apartheid struggle. And if you think about that CD and go back and listen to it, that represented to me an artist identifying his prime role. And so when you think of the song Equal Rights, and in Equal Rights, towards the end of the song, when he started listing all the people fighting for equal rights, he spoke about Palestinians fighting equal rights. And I say, and if you think this is 1977, how many Jamaicans even thought of the anti-apartheid struggle, much less thinking about the rights of the Palestinians? On that CD, there was this, the song Apartheid. There was a song which in a sense was a call, it summoned all people of color to unity, African. It's interesting, in that song, he starts at local level and he goes through the different parishes, where they're from, Westmoreland, where he's from. And naturally he had to make reference to Clarendon, where I am from. But then he stepped out. He went into the different religions, and then he went international. And what he's saying, regardless of these things, what's fascinating about African, he spoke to the color question. Don't mind your complexion. You're still an African. And that spoke to me. That song raised to me. This is an artist who had reflected on the issue of injustice, the issue of our lack of identity. And in that one CD, he had put together his thoughts in a very coherent and musically attractive way. Now, why is this fascinating to me? Apart from the philosophy, apart from him advancing, speaking on the cause he felt so strongly about, how many musicians can you think of who would take on sensitive issues which are bound to be controversial, because there are not many people who were running to fight on behalf in the anti-apartheid struggle? How many musicians would, in trying to break through, would put out a CD built around a central theme? And you think of how many there would be. Marley's Survival came off some years later. That you could concede is a lovely saying. But to do this in 1977, there is what I had first heard to have been a rumor, but confirmed by the musician himself. He said that one of Tosh's backing musicians, I won't call a name now, but those of you who know will probably know. When Tosh came into the studio and said he was going to do this album dedicated to the anti-apartheid struggle, the musician, he confesses that he thought that Tosh had made up the word apartheid, because it sort of looked like something he would do. And here is someone in 1977 who had not gone beyond primary education, but who had read, listened a lot to the to international news, and so identified with this struggle, this important struggle in the world at that stage, that he dedicated a CD to it. He continued his struggle, and he continued with the Mama Africa album, itself a beautiful album. And on that, there's Mama Africa, and then it goes back to his theme. But he would always be in the anti-apartheid struggle, not gonna give it up. That was another beautiful song along the same theme. One of the things you always wonder when your heroes pass on early, what would they have been at this point in time? How would they have viewed developments? How would they view what their successors in the industry, who have in a sense stood on their shoulders, how would they have viewed what they have carried forward the music. And this is not the time to comment on it, but you should have your own views on that. But his last album, his last studio album, No Nuclear War. Again, I found this fascinating because it seemed to me that having gone international with his anti-apartheid position, here he is taking on that fight, which still should be joined, the fight against the proliferation of nuclear weapons. And that album in itself, and I would urge those who haven't listened carefully, demonstrate a reflective touch. And it is significant to me, and I don't know whether I'm reading too much in it, in that this was a less combative touch. This is a touch who was speaking about the anti-nuclear fight, the anti-nuclear struggle. But in the very, very, very last song, on the last album he did, is We've Got to Come Together, Learn to Love One Another. And it seemed to me that none of us can predict when anyone will drop out. None of us can decide whether it's the right time or not. But that CD being released just before his death, and the final cut on that CD stroke album, We've Got to Come Together, Learn to Love One Another, is in a sense projecting to me what his view, how his view of the world had emerged, had evolved. Peter Tosh, activist and protagonist, most will tend to remember his fight against for I don't know if it's for the legalization or decriminalization of marijuana. Legalization of marijuana. Strident in this, always consistent in his position. Both with legalize it, but also subsequent songs speaking to the need to remove what is really a cruel and unjust punishment for this offense. But you never fail to know his positions. His positions were clearly articulated, uncompromising. And so it's my pleasure to join in this symposium where we salute Peter Tosh, the musical genius, the activist, and the protagonist. Thank you very much.
Again, another very disciplined and well-timed talk. I'm really, basically enamored at this point in time because I'm used to signaling and, giving a time card. But no, not happening today. Everybody is on cue. So right about now, I know that while Copeland is getting ready, I wanted to show a little video footage. One of the videos is a trailer for a documentary from Karine Karim.
We got to build a better nation. Clean up.
Some boys who miss their fathers go off the rails. Others channel their longing into hard work and excellence. Was larger than life, but to his mother Alvira, he was plain and simply our loving son, Peter.
Or there will be no future for you, you and me.
I want to now show a musical video, Can't Blame the Youth, which was the topic of Clinton's talk. The Wailers performing. It's a nice piece of footage if we can get it.
You can't blame me. teaching you is to learn in school. They call jungle. About Christopher Columbus, and you said he was a very great man. You teach the youth about Marco Polo, and you said he was a very great man. You teach the youth about the pirate Hawkins, and you said he was a very great man. So you can't blame the youth, and you can't fool the youth. You can't blame the youth, not at all. You can't fool the youth. Oh. 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 All these great men were doing robbing, raping, kidnapping, and killing. So-called great men were doing robbing, raping.
Classic Peter Tosh along with the Wailers, and I deliberately chose that video to show because not only because of the song, Blame the Youth, but I like to see when they all perform together, Bonnie, Bob, and Peter. And obviously Peter wrote that song. So right now we're going to go into our next presentation, our next panelist, and it gives me great pleasure to introduce Mr. Copeland Forbes, who is a former road manager of Peter Tosh, road manager, who toured the world with this enigmatic reggae singer, during which time he gained many personal insights into the talent and personality of the legendary Mystic Man. Copeland Forbes is a veteran of the Jamaican music industry, having been involved in the industry for almost 50 years now. He has worked with most of the leading reggae performers for over 30 years, including Bob Marley, including Bonnie Wailer, you name them, he's worked with them. Currently, Copeland Forbes is working on his book, speaking to his 50 years of experience in the reggae industry, and he will speak more to that. But I must say, in interacting and working with Copeland the last couple of years or so, I'm very impressed with his energy, his passion for reggae music, and his knowledge about the industry and the movers and shakers in the industry. So it gives me great pleasure to have him here, to welcome him again to this 2011 Peter Tosh Symposium. So without further ado, let's give Copeland Forbes a big welcome here at the 2011 Huey Peter Tosh Symposium. Thank you, Copeland Forbes.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, brothers and sisters. Well, people know me as a long talker, and tonight it's going to be the shortest talk we're going to get, because the father worked that I never get to stop home to pick up my notes. You know what I mean? Because time was running out, so the notes, everything is left in my living room. And I had to come here bareback. So a few minutes I was here, from my knowledge and thing, I was able to put it together. When I was asked by Dr. Michael Barnett to speak, and he sent this word to me, protagonist, I have to dig deep in a 5 dictionary to make sure, say, I'm going to talk about the writing. Because when I see this word, protagonist, I said, my God, it sounds like an antagonist. So I went into the Webster's, I said the meaning. I went into the other one, the Macmillan, and I went into about 10 of them just to make sure that I'm not going to talk the wrong thing. But it's a very good topic. And the speakers before me, Dr. Omar Davidson, Dr. Clinton, I'm not Dr. Forbes, you know, but doctor of reggae music, though. Yeah, if you call me on that, I'm the doctor for that. I'm going to make it very brief tonight. But before I start off, you see, I'm going to just concentrate mainly on some of his songs and the reason why these songs were constructed, because I was there when some of them were constructed, and the meaning behind it, because Peter can be one of the most misinterpreted person based on how he speaks, you know? I mean, if he don't say suicide, he says sui back, you know? Him call Chris Blackwell, Chris White worse, you know? Him call Sly and Robbie, Fly and Rob Me. Him call Herbie Miller, Herbie Killer. I never get where, you know, because my name is Copeland Forbes, and him call me Copeland Fraud. So, you know, everybody have a little nickname, but he was just a very humorous person, and he finds the adjectives to match it in his own way. But yet still, you can still understand what he's saying, and you can relate to it. The most simplest thing you can relate to, even my baby can relate to him when he speaks, because he doesn't use the protagonist kind of words. He goes straight to the point. Okay, but before I start off in just going down some of his songs that were interesting to me, I just want to take this time out to just introduce some of his children who are here with us, because I knew them from they were kids, and they are all here. With Michelle, Irone, Steve, can you just come up here for a second? Because you are the people who are going to carry on the message and the work of your father. I'm going to leave one of them out because he's going to speak, so I can't bring in Brother Dave. But these are some of them, right? Out of the 10 children, right? Brother Steve. Yes. He's the first one, you know, the one in the middle. Right? And I know Peter is proud of his children, you know. And thank you all, right? I remember a few years ago, while we were in Europe, I went out on a tour. With Andrew was on tour with me, and I said, Andrew, no matter what, we're going to find Nabi, because the last time I saw Nabi, he was 3 years of age. And when we finally found him in 2006, he was 26 years of age. And he joined us on the tour. And he's not into music and singing. He's into medicine and the whole deep side of his father. One more person I'd like to acknowledge here, and this person is one of the most important person here tonight. And the reason for me introducing this person, because a lot of symposiums and gatherings and talks and discussion about Peter has been going on for years, here, there, and everywhere. And this person has always been left out for whatever reason, I don't know. But I have been there from the beginning, and I was there up to the end. And I know that this person played a great, great role in Peter's life, no matter how people may look at it, right, or how you may conceive it to be. But this person was there right up to the moment when he passed on. And nobody can give the story like this lady. We're just going to say a special welcome to Sister Marlene Brown. Where are you at? Just stand, let everybody see you. Yes, this is Sister Marlene Brown. And she can give you blow by blow of what happened on that fatal night. Because she was there. She got injured too, and she's here to tell the tale. Okay, I'm just going to define it down easily. One of the things I used to have, I would say it's a problem with Peter. I used to ask him, Peter, I notice when you're constructing a song, you know, I don't see you write out the lyrics. You know, Peter may write two lines, right? And then you don't say anything. You see an empty space, and you see a one word, and you see an empty space, and you don't say anything else. And I asked him one day, how come you can you write a song like that? He said, man, can't write out everything, you know, because them pirates, they will just come teeth it when they put it down. So he stored most of it in his head, especially the most important part, you know. He will just have the hook lines, if it's a common word that's used, the hook lines, but the rest of it is stored in his head. That sometimes when the song is finished now, and he has to put it down, you know, for on paper now, so we can send it in for publishing. He has to remember some of the things that he had, you know, because there are so much things stored in that head. But that little head of his stored a lot of things. Because I remember when we went to Africa, after that beating with the police, you know, and we went up into Benin Mountain, and we went to a bush doctor. And the minute we walk into the shrine, the man look at him and say, you see you? People think you're a madman, but you're not a madman, right? You're a very smart man. You're an intelligent man, but you have some poison in your head that needs to come out. Other from that, you are one of the greatest men on earth. And he told him something secretly that I can't talk now, to come out in the book, that he should do to preserve himself, because he saw some things inside of him. And when the gentleman said that to him, you know, a lot of things resonated in my head, you know. And I said, boy, Peter, the amount of things you have stored in your head, plus, remember, you know, you got 46 stitches in your head after the beating with the policeman, and you still can be able to store so many songs in your head, that we went down to a river, and we were sitting by the river, and he was fishing, because he loves to fish. The water is his side in October. So he loves to fish. And he was fishing, and I just walked up the top of the river, was looking, and then I saw something that I can't even describe, you know, was happening in the river while he was down the bottom catching the fish. Well, I tell you what it is. A man was passing his feces in the water up the top, and him down the bottom catching fish. So I went back down and I said, Peter, dash for every fish. He said, why? I said, every fish dash them way. And he said, why? I said, come up and come look up and go up there. And you know him usually the word bongo. No, well, I'm going to say bongo clippings, but you know what I'm saying. Right there and then, he sat down and he looked at it. And that's where this song, Mama Africa, was constructed, when he said Africa is the richest place, but it has the poorest grace. And to me, it's such a disgrace. That's why I'm not gonna give it up. I'm not going, I'll be fighting until Africa and all Africans are free, right? That song came to him right on that spot there. And he kept singing the song while we were driving along in the Range Rover. And he just had the hook lines, just the hook lines. And by the time we got back to our bungalow, he had the song all constructed out. Then he looked at me and said, you know something? You ever hear about glass house? And I said, yeah. He said, you know, say if you live in a glass house, you can't throw a stone in it. I said, that's true, because people can't see a stone in your back. And he sat down right there that night when one of the obas had passed on. So there was a vigil outside behind our thing, and him keep saying, boy, look like them can't see me. And he constructed glass house right on the spot there. It's a brother that everyone knows is very militant. And most of his songs are so militant. that one day I said to him, "Wom, how come you not sing the love song?" He said, "Well, I'm tired of singing about darling, I love you and all them bongo clipping sting. You know, I have to sing about the revolution and the fight and the struggle and so on." And you know something? Peter had one of the most loving side of him. Marlin can tell you that when he sits down and gets into that mood, the love lyrics start to flow. And he had a song named Rock With Me that most Jamaicans probably have never heard it. It was released as a single, but it was never pushed to the forefront because, you know, radio stations, people don't see Peter as a Mr. Lover. So they see something come with loving, they wouldn't push that. But that's one of the sweetest songs you can ever hear, you know. We have it, I won't give you a rundown on it shortly. And I love that song, that every time that we're on the road, I always tell the band, push in rock with me, because that song is so sweet. When he says, "You're the sweetest rocker in town, and I don't want to see you go down. You're the sweetest rocker in town. I don't want to see you go and rock your rock with me. Roll your roll with me." You can hear it. Then there's another song that hit my head off in 1979 on the Mystic Man album. And it's there are two songs on it. One was The Day the Dollar Die, and another one was Crystal Ball. And if you listen to the lyrics of Crystal Ball, it's like he saw things way ahead, like 20 years ahead. When he sings about, "We don't want no nuclear war," he saw things way ahead. He had that vision to pick up things way ahead. And I said to him, "Crystal Ball is a thing that mesmerized me," you know, and him say, "Yeah, man." And I actually experienced the Crystal Ball incident when we were in Nigeria, you know, because the day we were trying to find King Sonny there, we couldn't find him, and we went to a bush doctor, a guy that's carried to a bush doctor. And when I talked to the man, I said, "The man, go in the fridge and take out a bottle of whiskey, take out a bottle of rum, take out a bottle of thing and start pour out and giving us a drink." So we said, no. Then he said, "Okay, for me to look at you, you know, it's going to cost you some money." I said, "Yeah, okay." We took $10,000 with us, US dollar, for the 4 weeks. I mean, 1982, that go a long way. And to put it in a nutshell, the man charged us 60,000 naira. That when I look on the zeros, I said, "Peter, you sure them zeros ain't at the right place? Because old man, I got charged with 60,000 naira just for us examining, so." And then I said to the man, I said to Peter, I went pull a trick on him. I said, listen, we have to go to the record company to make a call to the US to speak to our accountant to send down some money, because we didn't come with that amount of money. You know, so we have to go there. He looked at us and he said, "You sure?" I said, "Yeah. Because I just want to get out there. Somehow my spirit just never feel right." When the man said 60,000 naira just for examining him head. Anyway, to put it in a nutshell, when we walked out of the shrine, I was going, the man run us down and said, "You come back here. First, I have to let you know if it's the right day to go to record company." So the man bring us back into the shrine and came out with three crystal balls. It was on a string. And him start to spin the crystal ball, and so on. So we must look at the crystal ball. And me, I look upon it till my head I go so. And Peter sit down, so I look upon it. And you know, film bird again, bongo, and all that. So when the crystal ball them stop, the man said, "Oh, crystal ball say it's not good day to go to record company." So we said, "Okay, we go back to the hotel." So Mr. Peter, we are go at the record company. No care what the man I say. Because Smith feels said something the man no want to go see. And we tell the man we're going back to the hotel. And we went back to the hotel. We went to the record company, and there we found King Sonny there looking for us. Can't find us. And when I told him that this man charge us 60,000 naira, Sonny said, "Ah, what is he gonna do? Make a human being? He's a thief. Come on, let's go." And took us our things and we went away. The song Crystal Ball keep ringing in my head. This experience with the crystal ball never left me. You know, and I see saying to Peter, I said, "Boy, yes, this crystal ball song, you have anything further to, you know, in depth with it?" And so him, so holy thing for come, man. So 3 days later, we were going up to Benin to see Sonny's father, the real bush doctor. So while we were pack up the Range Rover, with water, bread. We go to the market, we buy up everything, we buy a stove, because we go up near the mountain for 3 weeks. A guy run, come out with a little note and say, Dr. Ikiriku say to give you this. So we look upon the note and we see it. It's, please come to me now, or else destruction will reach you. And we look through it to Peter, and I say, Peter, you can't look at the crystal ball and tell where this me now. And I say, boy, I tell you. So don't pay that no mind. So I show it to Sonny. Sonny say, rubbish, and crush it up and throw it at the garbage. Anyway, to put it in a nutshell, the crystal ball still sit in my head. And after about 4 hours of driving up to Benin, and I look over the speedometer, I was like, we're going about 180 kilometers, flying up the highway. All of a sudden, I hear a sudden explosion, and boom! I was sitting in the back, you know, Peter in the front beside the driver, and Sonny, King Sonny are there, and his brothers behind me in another vehicle. And I hear, boom, a big explosion. That time, Nigeria was run by a military government at the time. So the first thing started running in my head, the snipers, them from out the bush, take us out on the highway, or somebody plant a bomb, or that bush doctor that we didn't go to said something under the vehicle. But all I can hear when the explosion, I hear Peter shout, Ja, Ja, and I fly over in the front, tear off the wall of my knee, blood a fly, and Peter shout, Ja, Ja, see me on the vehicle, I skid. I couldn't say anything. I was skid for about 50 yards. And when it stopped, I jumped through the window, and I run in a bush, because I figured the vehicle would explode. And him take time, come out, and him look on it. And him say to me, say, remember where the Christie song in a crystal ball say? Explosion, bombing, and thing, see China, right? I was scared to go back in the vehicle. When you look, the right tire, and the right front tire, and the left back tire burst all at the same time, right? And we were left on this highway for hours, until we finally bought some tires and ended up in Benin, way in the night. That song meant something to me, because while we were up in Benin, we went through some other things. And he starts writing and putting down more songs. Mama Africa was the theme of his visit. Hence the album Mama Africa came. That album, I feel so strong about it, because I actually experienced some of the songs. I was actually there when he was writing it. I saw how he constructed the songs, how it came about from experiences that he has been through. The speakers before me spoke about songs like You Can't Blame the Youths. You know, he always resonated to say that we as youths were forced to read about people like Sir Francis Drake, Henry Morgan, and all those people, and who they were. They were pirates, and all they were doing is robbing, raping, kidnapping, and killing. You know, but we were forced to read and study them in our school books, because I used to get beaten at Chatula Park to read and study about Henry Morgan. So being around Peter and see he brings out these things in his songs, it brought back a lot of memory to me, and some good moments that I always like to be around him, because I know a song is going to come up at some point. I remember when we were doing the same album, and Donald Kinsey, his lead guitarist, brought the song Johnny B. Good down and said, yeah man, he wants us to do this song. Peter never even know which song was that. He never even know who sing the song. We laid the rhythm down at Dynamics, and we get the lyrics sheet, and the day when he's supposed to voice the song, and him look on the lyrics, and he say, deep down in Louisiana, close to New Orleans, and one line, he say, you got to be the leader of a rock and roll band. Him say, no way me sing this song. He walk out the studio, and he would say, I'm not voicing the song. The rhythm was so good, and he say, I'm not voicing the song. And I appeal, and no way. His brethren come on, and that helped sink the whole idea. But you know what I did? I called him one side, and I said, Peter, is you teach me how to cook porridge and how to cook soup. And I remember what you put in the soup. Now, after you put in all the ingredients, you make it simmer, you put in the thing, the seasoning, and then you taste it. Now, when you taste it, you say, yes, the soup ready. I said, you are the seasoning for this song now. And I think you should have just voiced the song, right? And when it's finished, and mix. If you don't like it, then I can't say anything about that. It's up to your choice. It took us a hard time to get him to do it, because one of his brethren was there convincing him, no, no, you have songs like your vampire and them thing that they sang for record. So him brethren went to get a dry herb theme. And I used up that time that the brethren left. And I said to the engineer, Chris Kims, was his name, how much track we have? 16? We're going to use up every 16. And Peter, him say him not going over, him going one take down. And if making a mistake, him not going back over it. But I had to change up the lyrics. I sat there in the studio and I took out Deep Down in Louisiana. So it said Deep Down in Jamaica, close to Mandeville. We interject that word there. And the next part was when he said, you got to be the leader of a rock and roll band. He said, no, no, no. Somebody said, you got to be the leader of a reggae band. And then I interject this thing, skenge, skenge, to make you know we're talking about a reggae band. So when we put that on the sheet and everything, said, okay, dark up the studio, put the lyrics sheet, chase out everybody and spin the tape fast. And him start to voice the song, and him voice the song, and him make a mistake. And him said, come forward. I said, throw him on another track. And him going into the song. Every time going to him getting into the song so much that him start to enjoy it now, because the rhythm, I mean, everybody know the song, the rhythm was rocking. And him said, go forward again. And we threw him another track. We use up 12 track on his voice that night just to make sure we get everything. And as him done, right, him just jump into the Volvo and him gone. And we sat there in the night and we sit down and we start piece them up. We never have the technology we have these days to fly them, you know, them things there. But we worked on it that whole night to get the song and get the parts them in. And then when the song was finished, mixed and everything, and we were going up to CBS, there were two songs on the album, him said, him don't want on the album. That was one, and the next song that Donald Kingsley wrote, named Where You Gonna Run, Where You Gonna Hide. And the reason why I think that he was influenced by a hangers-on again, because the hangers-on, they're not good for the artists, you know, because they're no good for right from wrong. He was influenced by another hangers-on. No, put them songs upon your album, boss, because you write them, you know what I mean? I had a man write them, and I sing the white man's song. Anyway, the songs were finished and done. So when we got up to New York and we were sitting, I was able to get the president of CBS at the time, Dick Asher. Normally you don't speak to the president, you speak to the A&R department. But through Danny Sims' connection that I had, he was able to get the president and all the A&R staff to come down into the listening room and sit down. And the songs are playing. And you know something? When it reached Johnny B. Goodman and playing and playing and playing, Peter said to me, I will sing that song there. Me say, Chuck Berry. Him say, what do you mean Chuck Berry? Me say, you know, remember that song the way they put him guitar and I said, go, 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 Johnny, go, and a jump cross. Him say, that song there. Me say, yeah. Him say, no, big song that, man. Put it on the album. I said to myself, boy, see, the man is sitting by himself, listening to the song, the construction of the song, the lyrics and how the song is flowing, and by himself, him just make the decision by himself. Then he went to the next song, which was, he was swayed by his friends again, not to put on the album, which was the song, Where You Gonna Run, Where You Gonna Hide. And you know, Peter, when he listened to the lyrics, and Dick Asher heard a saxophone solo on the song, and he stopped the tape and said to me, who is that saxophonist there? This was 1982, you know. I said, it's a little youth in Jamaica we call Youth Sax. His name is Dean Fraser. And Dick said, I've never heard of that guy, but he sure plays a mean sax. And then Peter listened to the lyrics, and Peter turned to me and said, you know something, Copeland? I said, what? Me write that's true name, so don't press a man. Where you gonna run to? And that song that means something to me. And you know, this song, yeah, have the lyrics, them, I mean the same kind of thing. When me defend, and when me stand for, you know something, I want it on the album too. And he was there going through the songs them, picking them by himself in his dark glasses, sitting down with no disturbance, no hangers on, making the selection of the songs that he thought fit for him at the time and what he was projecting. And I remember now when Margadog came up now. Sorry for Margadog, Margadog, wrote on her own bite. In at the end, him did bust a little word there that you know call indecent, but It was a humor thing he did in the studio, and the producer loved it and decided that he would keep it on the record. Anytime you get play that record, and you say, Marga dog, you know, when it come down to the end, there's a so-called bad word there, right? But he did it in the studio out of humor, but the producer loved it, and to him, he said, not bad. It sound humorous, and he kept it on the record while some dogs, and flying some dog voices of some dog barking in that spot. And when it reached that song and it started playing, and Dick Asher turned to me and said, what kind of cloth is that? And I said, it's a raw cloth from Jamaica. I had to pretty it up nice, you know what I mean? Because I didn't want to let him know it was one of those kind of words. But he loved it just the same because it sounds so humorous. And they kept it on the record. Anytime you play that record, you will always hear it. So, you know, his choice of songs was, he made the choices themselves. Now, on the Wanted album, there was a song, say, oh, Bumba, and you know the rest. That song, I can tell you, one musician said to me, that's Robby Lynn, him said Copeland, anyway, I play the song, and not staying on the bandstand. You know? So we never put it in the program. But one night, I think it was the Ritz Theater in New York, and Peter just feel for that song, and him just turned to the band, and they say, him want that song. And as the intro start, me go see the keyboard man just start walk to the dressing room. One keyboard alone finished the song. We spoke to him about it. He said there's nothing wrong with it, because his usual word, and he want to drive a doppy, and he want to get away evil spirits from around him. He just say it, so if he can't say it, he must can't sing it. Record company never even know what it mean neither, so them keep it on the record. You know. Then when we were doing the NBC special, Walk and Don't Look Back. Now, I mean, that's a Motown song with the Temptations, you know. It wasn't really a song that he would have just jumped to do. But it was a song suggested by his team to break him into the mainstream, because at the time we were touring and opening for the Rolling Stones. And then Mick Jagger decided to do a part on the song. That even many times on the tour, when Peter is touring by himself, if Mick can make it, he just comes in and don't tell anybody. He just show up and he just come. So people always come expecting to see a Mick Jagger. Sometimes when Mick is not there, we have people like Carly Simon would fill that spot. And any guest people who are in the area just want to fill a Mick Jagger spot. But that night when we were doing that filming at NBC, one of his backup singers at the time, you know, he had three females. One of the Tamlins, yes, it was Gwen Guthrie, Fonda Rae, and Afeeza. Three of them were singing that night. And Gwen Guthrie brought a song, right? And she was singing it to me in the dressing room, and she said she and Peter to sing it. And when I started listening to the song, I said, boy, Gwen, I wish you luck in getting Peter to do that the song. Because that the song too loving. And me know him now go down that the love lane. So loving. But somehow she went in and sat with him, and she started singing it. And singing it and telling the part that he would sing and the part that she would sing, and it sounded very good. And then they went into the studio and they recorded that as a song, Nothing But Love, you know. And that was the song that went up on the charts in the United States that year from that album, and kept riding the charts to the top. And it was unbelievable, because nobody expected that song would have done the work that it did. But it was amazing to everyone. Everyone was kind of surprised. Even Peter himself was kind of surprised. But he said, a good song will never die. I'm not going to take up too much time, but I want to, yeah, the speech, the one love, number seven, right? I'm just going to close off, because I have so much thing to say. But like I said, it will be in the book, and the book is coming out next year. Next year, I must tell you though, while he's getting the song together, next year, we have a very big plan for Peter next year. Next year is Peter's 50th anniversary, and it's his 25th anniversary. I'm going to explain that now. It's his 50th anniversary because he was part of the Wailers, and it's the Wailers' 50th anniversary next year, and they'll be celebrating that along with Jamaica's 50th year of independence, and it's my 50 years in the entertainment industry too, right? It will be Peter's 25th anniversary of his transition. I remember he transitioned in 1987. So it will be, he'll be celebrating two milestones, right? We will be celebrating his work and his life. Two milestones, the 50th and the 25th. And one of the highlights of next year will be a special tour which will entail all the members who have played in this band, World Sound and Power. Every single one. We have two drummers, two bass players, Fully and Santa, Sly and Robbie, Robbie Lynn, Mike Chung, Donald Kinsey, Daryl Thompson, Keith Sterling, just about everyone, the Tamblins, and it will be led by his two sons on lead vocal, which is Andrew Tosh, and his youngest son, Tosh One. And that tour is gonna call Remembering Peter, because it's such a special year, 50th and the 25th. And that is something to look forward to, because I just finished negotiating a very big deal with a major company in England who were the ones who were putting on that last Michael Jackson tour at the O2. And they are elated about it. And there's a lot of plans coming for that. And because they think that Peter deserves more than what he's getting now. In 1978, when everybody heard about this famous One Love concert, which the Wailers actually were supposed to perform together, right? But there were a few little itches and things that prevented them from performing together. And I remember one of the things that stood out was it wasn't the people who called the peace, right? No, it wasn't the government who called the peace, it was the people. You see what I mean? So some evil forces may creep in. So they decided to do it single-handed then. And that night, unrehearsed, Peter took the opportunity to just express himself on stage in a way that later on, he really confessed to me and told me that that's what really cost his life when he was badly beaten by the police in Alpha 3, because he told me that there were inside sources told him that after that concert, they were out to get him at some means, any means necessary. And everybody knew what happened in Alpha 3 while he was standing there waiting for Sly and Robbie. And he was just accosted by an unidentified man, plain clothes, grab him call it a roach, grab him roach from him, grab back the roach. The man grab back the roach, him grab it back. So the man hang on to him and start to manhandle him. And you know, Peter know karate and kareza, and he decided to defend himself because a civilian trying to manhandle him. So he defend himself and apply like a karate move inside of it. Anyhow, the man went away and brought two more men and come and they start manhandling him. And then what happened now is that one of the police took out his gun to hit him in his head. And you know, him very smart and him good at karate, I tell him, just shift out of the way and the gun tear off the policeman's face. So what happened, he said when he went down to the police station and the man in charge said, "We had Corporal Brown, oh, you full of blood, so what do you?" He said, "No, the dread mash me down." And then he said, that's when they took him in a room and he said 10 policemen went for over an hour and beat him. His hands were broken, his head was smashed up, he had to get 46 stitches in his head. Literally, he had to play dead to be alive, because he said the way his head was open, if he had taken one more blow inside of it, it would have mashed up his head. So he turned his head to a wall, so he couldn't take any blow. At one point, he said he was trying to go through a window, because you know him slim, and he said fly through the window, but half of him stuck down and so, and then gave him one lick with a chair, cross him back, broke his back, and him have to drop back down on the ground. But you know something, he fought on, and he had a tour coming up like 3 weeks later, and I thought he was gonna cancel the tour. And you know something, this is how great an artist he is, and you know, when he's so focused on what he wants to do, and he went out and did that tour, you know, with the stitches in his head just the same way, with the pain in his head, but his music meant so much to him that he wanted to just go out on the tour so the world could hear his music. I remember when we were in Swaziland, you know, I'm going to wrap up before I come to that. When we were in Swaziland, and we had about 40,000 people inside the stadium. I don't know what happened, but his cousin was just being held by the police because of a spliff. Can you imagine you being arrested for a spliff in Africa, and them whole culty said, lock him up because of a spliff. And I'm trying to plead to the police, plead to the police, plead to the police, plead to the police. And then all of a sudden I hear the music stop. I didn't know what happened. My dear queen can't tell you what happened. But she was there. It's later on I found out anyway. Peter had heard that there was about 5,000 people outside who really couldn't afford the money to come in. It wasn't much. I think it was about $2-3 to get in. But they couldn't afford $2 to get in. And when he heard that, he decided that the only way he can get his music to the real people that he wanted was to stop the show. So I'm going to stop the show, bloom. And when I turn and I look on the stage, I see no music playing. And I'm taking the mic and I'm saying, right now, word for word, no, I'm going to quote now. Them promoters are some imperialists, socialists. I hear every is in the book, right? And I'm saying, open the gate and let in everybody inside there because my music is for the people. It's not for politicians. Politicians, the prefix poly means ticks, are people who move as ticks. And him start on the mic, and the people outside heard. And let me tell you something. The man who was arresting Carl T after run left him, and that saved him, the officer, because he had to run to the gate and open the gate because the walls of the stadium was about to come down, and they let in everybody. And the people them just run inside the stadium. And that was the time when he drew for his M16 guitar and the song Apartheid. And when he started that song, I tell you, he didn't have to sing one more song after that. That song went on for about half an hour straight because it was like a song that liberated the people. The lyrics meant so much to them. And to see the freedom fighter himself in Swaziland. And I tell you something, it was easy to get there, you know, because Peter said he doesn't want his face to even be seen nowhere near South Africa. So we had to fly from here to London, and from London to Zimbabwe, and then from Zimbabwe, we had 5 private planes, took us from there, and we went down to Swaziland. Because, you know, Swaziland is a black country within the southern part of Africa. And to get there, most people have to go through South Africa. Even though a lot of the fans came from South Africa, because people were walking for 4 or 5 days from Johannesburg, from Cape Town, coming through the borders. The soldiers and police couldn't understand. They have never seen this in their life. So many people trekking down, and when they ask, what is it? They said it's a reggae concert by Peter Tosh. The soldier would ask, who is Peter Tosh? They said a freedom fighter. So when they hear that, they just lock the border. So people gathered at the border, couldn't pass the border. Because they hear the word freedom fighter, they start to think differently. But they didn't realize that this freedom fighter was fighting musically with his instruments and his music and his lyrics. And then when Peter took up the M16 guitar, which is the only one in the world until this very day. And I think we still have to give Sister Marlene credit for keeping it for 1987 until now. She has that guitar, and we have to give her credit for that. That guitar could have disappeared, but she kept it. I knew she had it all the years, right? So now, yes, thank you there. Anyway, Mr. Mann is on my case. I tell you, so, you know, we need 8 hours like Castro, you know. You know? Because there's so much to talk. But anyway, I would just, in closing, I would just like to say that it was a great opportunity to come here every year and speak to the people about such a great man. I tell you something, I dream about Peter every day because he was part of my life. He contributed so much in the 50 years because actually, you know, I started out working with them when they were the Wailers in the United States, when it was Joe Higgs filling in for Bonnie Wheeler after he left. And I was on that tour where we got left in with Sly and the Family Stone group in Las Vegas because they didn't know that the Wheelers were so powerful and they kicked us off the tour. So I started working from then. I'd say somebody that I've been close to over the years. I've learned a lot. He was like a teacher. He was like a brother. He was like a friend. He's just about everything for me. And I just can't wait for next year when we're going to celebrate his work and the life of such a great man, Peter Tosh. Long lives Peter Tosh and his memory. Thank you.
As Copeland mentioned, he brought Marlene Brown here to say a few words. So I'm going to allow Sister Marlene to talk for about 5 minutes.
Well, today's my birthday also, you know. I'm 50 today. Yeah. So it's really an honor to be here celebrating Peter's birthday on my birthday. Bro. Yeah, man. Right now, me not telling a lie still, you know. When we use a T-foot to buy, but I always come meet Peter Tosh, you know. When be 17-year-old, I never know, say, I would not get this opportunity to be here representing Peter Tosh. Yes. Because at the time, I did just view Peter Tosh as a lover. But within all of that, this man don't stop teaching me. I tell you, the man teach me. One of the greatest teaching is that at the time, I was still attending school, you know, and I used to do, I was in like the business ed, so I used to type. So Peter come to me one day and said, Marlene, you can type out some of my lyrics them for me? Come, I want to publish some of them, you know. And I just want my lyrics them for type out. So, and bring the album them and say, you have to listen to it, you know. So, and bring a record player and then bring me a typewriter. Because me the poor, you know, so I couldn't afford to buy one typewriter. And when the man bring the typewriter come now, that's rotted. No man, this is a challenge. So I'ma take the album them now. I'ma start listen to them, write out the lyrics them. I will be write out the lyrics them. I book up on one name, fight apartheid. So I'ma say, wait. What Peter Tosh mean by fight apartheid? I never know if me they spell the word right, apartheid, because it's the first me ever hear that word. And me, I go to school. So I'ma turn to Peter Tosh. I'ma say, Peter, what you mean by fight apartheid? And the man started explaining to me. It's when Peter explained to me. I said, no, Peter, I can't believe this man. Yet him say me, I go to school. I mean, never hear the word apartheid yet. No, man, something wrong, man. So me decide now, say, I go fight with this man, you know. I mean, I tell you, say, it's from that man explained that word to me. My old dream and aspiration was just to help this man fight for our people in South Africa. So I got to work. I'm start work with the brother. Anything him need to be done, we just do it. He said to Mr. Marlene, then after me get a job now, I work for a credit union. I do account stipend and filing. Peter said, no, Marlene, man, come out of that, man. Come work for me, man. I'm going to say, yeah, true. He said, yeah, man. I'm going to open the office and put you in it, man. I'm going to say, all right. I'm open the office now, then I turn him secretary. I'm start do all I'm typing work. Then him start bringing books them. I'm start auditing books them for him. Because he used to tell me that 4 years at school doing accounts. I say, yeah. And when I start auditing books them and really start going in and work, I never say no, sir. But just live a my whole life to this man. Work and struggle. I just feel good. And thank you very much, because this is the continuation of my work. Because me never know, say, today would have bring me right in front of all you great people. Thank you very much for Anna Peter Tosh. Give thanks here.
So now it is time for one of Peter's sons to grace the stage and say something about his father. I'm very glad that we have such a turnout from Peter's family. It is great. And David is, I believe, he has been charged with the responsibility of looking after the mausoleum in Westmoreland, in Belmont there. So maybe he'll even speak to that. But without too much ado, because we want to have a question and answer session, could I ask David Tosh to grace us, please? Let's give it up for David Tosh.
Everybody know my name already. I really don't have much to say. Just here to pay my respect to the man who brought us all here today, Peter Tosh. I am like I'm saying, not much of a talker, but I just want to touch upon a couple of points today regards to just Peter in life. I hear a lot of people come up and they talk about the song, "You Can't Blame the Youth." And it kind of touched me because it's a song I love myself and it means a lot to me. In recent times, our business managers talking to, planning on doing some remasters, Peter Music with some other. What happened? Yeah, you know? All right. So, one of the things is we planned to do was remaster some songs such as Legalize It, You Can't Blame the Youth. And in talking to them, I make a suggestion. We look upon them and say, no, say, we have the top artists at Jamaica to put upon You Can't Blame the Youth right now. And them say, which artist that? They say, Vybz Kartel. And it's, like me say, it's kind of sad it never really happened. That's what me I deal with, because you will sit down, me will sit down and hear everybody now talk about, even in university and place like this, who will talk about a Peter Touch or a Bob Marley as being icons or whatever distinguished name they want to give them. However, me can remember as a child growing up, they weren't much of a people because them was all dirty at Rasta. That's what me I deal with. It's the same way them treat the same youths, even of today. While you hear people talking about You Can't Blame the Youth, it's a touching song because when you listen to the song, it says You Can't Blame the Youth. So if we cannot blame the youth for what is going wrong or what the wrongs or the hills that they are doing today, then who can we blame? That is a question. See, it's a lot of things that bother me. People, as Michael said, I'm charged with. I'm not really charged with much. I'm really charged with, or I consider myself being the lioness of the family who take care of the cubs. Meaning the lion, see? But it's like a lioness who take care of her cub. Lion not take care of a cub. Lion more for kill them. But what it is, I'm the one who keep the thing, the family together. And it's a thing where I realize even Peter had this in his struggle. And basically, my only weapon to keep the family together and keep a unity where we could build and grow was to use the truth. Because everybody else had their way of picking at each and trying to segregate by just basically lies. So my job is really just to keep the family together, keep the estate together so that we can move forward together. Seeing so, on that note, really, I'm not the most liked person in the family. I can't tell you that. And the reason being, one of the things I think is when Peter passed, we all had to go through, his children had to go through what was known as a kinship hearing to prove that we were, in fact, his children. And when they did it, they found that everyone, all of my siblings, were, in fact, Peter's children are a sibling of Peter. But when they checked my DNA, they realized I was Peter himself. So they don't like me. It's one of the things why I'm come up here with my spliff today. It's still even look outrageous for a Rasta man walk with a spliff in 2011 going on 2012. Where if you dip on half a tree road and you see a madman with a baseball bat, nobody don't say nothing to him. But if them see a Rasta man with a spliff, them look upon him as a madman. it's the type of system where I don't even understand, because it's even the same songs. It's something where would I even like to talk to. I'm glad Dr. Omar Davis is here, a member of parliament and politician. Because a lot of things where, one of the things where me concerned about, I mean, sit and me look and me ask myself, reggae music makes trillions of dollars annually, globally. Is enough money to have everybody in Jamaica living above the poverty line. Yet still Jamaica don't own no part of reggae music. And it's something I think the government, like me said, Dr. Davis here, him can't even look into it too. These things need for query. Because I see the MPs come together and they created all these inquiries over time and for all sorts of things. I think them need to query or inquire why Jamaica is not benefiting from reggae music. In no way whatsoever. And it's something where, as the head of the family and trying to guide the estate, may I try to guide them in having to understand certain things where, hey, yes, we have to collect our things abroad and all of these type of things, but I think at the end of the day, our future base should be in Jamaica. But then again, is Jamaica conducive to doing business? Is all of them type of things that you have to ask yourself. See, and it's, like I say, I really don't want to take too much time because it's really business and it's really a lot, we have a lot of work I have to do as far as these issues is concerned, because them personally concern me. And like me say, one of the main thing is I don't see where Jamaica benefit from reggae music. We go globally and you hear they say Jamaica, reggae, 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 Jamaica, 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 but I don't see it here. See, and so having said that, I just want to tell everybody, say, well, respect your coming out and thanks for coming and respect to the man. And on behalf of the family, we do appreciate and respect everybody showing up today. Thanks again.
Yeah, let's give it up for David Tosh again. Thanks for that frank expression of how you see yourself in regards to the rest of the family. Right now we have a small cultural contribution. I'm not seeing the brother who wanted to do the poem. So right now, well, when him come forward, we will take it. But let's go into question and answer. And what I would say is, Sister Marlene, I'm sure down the road people will want to hear a brief synopsis of what she suffered on that terrible day, the 11th of September, 1987. She's one of the survivors. I also want to point out that Mama Joy Dixon is another survivor of that fatal day, the what I see as the assassination of Peter Tosh on the 11th of September, 1987. And Free Eye Dixon, who was a good friend of Peter, sadly, he died the same day that Peter died in that hail of bullets. So when we think about the way Peter died, the tragic way, we just also give a thought for the friends who died and also the people who survived that day, because I know they have to live through that agonizing memory day after day. So I have to applaud them, Mama Joy Dixon and Marlene, for living through that terrible experience. So let's clap the survivors as well as the people who lost their lives on that day. All right, let me take the first question, please, for any of the panelists. Anybody? I saw Brother Becky stand up, but he sat down. Nobody else has a question? Yes.
Yeah, greetings, brothers and sisters.
All right. We turn on that mic.
Yeah, I too would like to pay my respect to Peter for his contribution to the Jamaican culture and to reggae music. But I noticed that the presenters were talking about Peter's music and discussing them. One of the music that Peter does that I would like to ask about is his music called Lion. And one that says, I don't feel no way. And in terms of Peter, for his own being, I think he expressed certain kind of anger in his music about certain issues in Jamaica. Everybody understand some of those issues, right? But what I'm asking, that now that Peter is gone, what does Peter really represent to us at this time? To me, Peter is from a country in the region that produces some very conscious music, right? And Peter seemed to play a great role in that. But for some reason, he's not happy with what, and I hear his son talking about Jamaica having reggae being such a powerful thing, and the people somewhere are not benefiting from this. So I'm just seeing that all of what we have given to the world in terms of culture and art and stuff, and a lot of people are benefiting from it, of which Peter seems to be the kernel or one of the most important ingredients in this creation. I would like to ask, what can be done for the youths coming in terms of the music industry to create new talents in this arena? Who can do this for Jamaica? That's my question.
You asked about 10 questions in one go, you know? But we're just going to make it brief. He said some very important points, you know, and I agree with him on a lot of them, too, because the reggae music is Jamaican music, right? And I want to tell you something. There's a band named Slightly Stupid, right, that plays ska and been touring the world. They're not Jamaicans, right? And they are playing ska, and they are benefiting from one of our creation, early creation. And I used to look around Jamaica, and I see a lot of musicians telling me, boy, right now, the work, the day in the bars, well, we can't get you some work. And I said, why you don't want to play some ska? Well, old music back, man, nobody don't want to hear. But the white boys take it up, right? And they are playing it, and they are benefiting from it. So it's an era where we need to create these avenues. Nothing is old, because it's our music, right? And it's music that we create, and it transcends from one, you know, the boogie-woogie to ska, to rock steady, to reggae, right, to dancehall. But it's a transition, but it's still all under one umbrella as Jamaican music. So I just encourage some of the new acts, them managers and people associated with us who are here, to just bring some of the acts into that arena where they can at least learn and know how many of the young acts know who Dan Drummond is. They don't even know who that is. You see what I mean? So we just need to have some more of these kind of avenues to expose them to it. And I'm sure the transition and the benefit will be there, because really and truly, when he said we're not benefiting, I can't tell you. I just experienced one yesterday where that Ragamuffin Festival that used to keep out in California every year, it used to be Bob Marley Festival, it's going to be no more. The promoter talked to me last night and said, Copeland, I'm done. It's over with, right? No more of that. You know, I don't need no more of these so-called whoever you have in Jamaica now saying they are reggae acts. So because it's not reggae, I'm going to use some Spanish, put on Spanish music. And our music is gone. And that's a great blow to us, because that festival, a festival we've been going for 26 years, and now we have lost it now. That's what Max Jacob told me, you know. And Summer Jam in Germany, he started using other hacks too, because our acts, them are not just moving up, and we're not creating the new ones that are coming up to take the place of the others. So that's a year we have to look into. So, next question.
One of the early speakers, Mr. Cotton, referred to Peter Tosh being influenced by Marcus Garvey, when I thought I should make the comment that I think his greatest influence was his Imperial Majesty Emperor Sebastian. And I'd also like to big up the Peter Tosh family that is here, and especially the son who just spoke, because he asked a very pertinent question. Why is it to this day, in 2011, that the use of our sacrament, marijuana, is still illegal? you know, and since 1932, they have had this Prohibition Act. I personally don't use marijuana anymore, but I think every man have a right to use this document. And why can't the government come to this issue? So I would like to ask the only government representative I see here, Mr. Omar Davis, the question. Why do you make your wars, and why do you continue to tell your lies?
Well, it's an interesting thing to be seen as a representative of the government. There was a recommendation on the matter of decriminalization. Well, I'm not sure whether it's decriminalization or legalization of the use of ganja. I have no doubt if it were brought to conscience vote to the House that recommendation would receive majority support. I suspect in a short time we should be able to dispose of that issue. The right things happen.
Dr. Davis, don't move. That issue, put it in its proper perspective. Hemp is not only a sacrament, it represents food, clothes, and shelter. Right now, as we speak, people are using hemp fiber to build buildings in the state. Right now as we speak. Hemp oil has omega 3, 6, and 9 fatty acids. What our body need in the correct proportion as they are. So when you're looking at the whole issue of ganja, hemp, let us look at the industries. A scientist once told me ganja have over 4,000 chemicals in it.
I didn't know I have all that information, but we live in the real world, and the real world is that even though within the U.S. there are states which have legalized the use, etc., the U.S. federal government itself, and especially in dealing with a country like Jamaica, has a very strong position, and it is part of the law that if, for example, anybody doing a medical test and if they find traces or a trace of marijuana in their bloodstream, they automatically cannot obtain a visa. This is something which is not our doing. So I think it, within the context of all the positive properties, we acknowledge that. But we also have to bear in mind the view of the U.S. in terms of their approach to the certain export of that. You could have something for personal use. I would not support export being legalized for personal use as something.
Yes, Dr. Davis, before you leave, just shortly. As you know, we are all here for Peter, okay? And we know the magnitude of the individual. We know that it's not Bob Marley alone carried the torch, nor Bunny, but Peter was a mainstay in the whole thing. Up till now, Peter has not been honored as he ought to. And we are really concerned, because we feel that being that the two were honored and Peter is left, it means the Wayland, the seal has not been put on the Wayland. And the Wayland is the greatest reggae group that has ever come out of Jamaica. For Peter not being honored, it's really a dishonor. And I'm asking you and the other parliamentarians, what can you do about it? Because reggae music is an industry We can't take it light. This is Jamaica's breadbasket. And as the song says, the youth, what are we teaching the youth? Are we saying that you must go to the university, graduate, come out, give an honorable contribution, and at the end of the day, your country don't want to honor you? Why? What are we teaching the youth? Shouldn't they be really encouraged in how you deal with the past performers? And I think every year I personally come to a Peter Tosh symposium, and our cry is always, what are we doing for Peter Tosh? I personally would like to see either the next Eros Day or the other Eros Day that some family member, because when I look for them youth for a while, I'm not in a lie, it's like a Peter Tosh me I look for. Now, I would like to see this man get his just honor, because he is really and truly an ambassador for reggae music in Jamaica. So I'm asking you, sir, what can we do?
Okay, let me answer briefly. The previous administration in which I served, we had taken a policy position that we didn't honor people post after their death. This administration has changed that, and I think therefore the obvious opportunity will exist for a strong lobby group. But do not put it on me alone. It's not enough.
I'm not.
It's not enough for you to come and then say, what are you doing? I think if there were an organized petition, etc., it would put pressure on government to convey an honor. Some honor. But at the same time, it's not just about an honor. There are lots of other things the media have to take us. Have to take some responsibility. Why is the music not played much more? You speak about the youth. Where are the youth here? And so there are other things which need to be done. It's not don't let us pass it off to the authorities together. There's work for us to do, yes, but there's work for a lot of other people to do. And I think the media need to answer. I think the youngsters need to answer why they are not appreciative of the work of your elders. But I would challenge this gathering to bond together and put pressure on government, regardless of whether it's my party or any other party, to honor this truly great song.
All right. The name is Walter Christus, and I live in Belmont, Westmoreland. So that must speak something. First, to the organizers, I would like to really ask, was the Minister of Culture invited here this evening? And what was the response? Because for a thing like this, it would really not really so good to know that an invitation was not sent. And she wasn't here to field questions, you know, because that's what I would want to know first. Government, we have Dr. Omar Davis here. Well, he's the organizer is over there. That's it. He'll come and answer. He's on the phone. The second one, Dr. Omar Davis, the opposition spokesman, and a member of parliament. I am not over-ambitious. I always believe in one cocoa full basket. So I'm saying that legalization is a big step, I think, to leave from it illegal to legalization. All right? I am really calling upon the university graduates, whether persons who have their PhD or whatever other qualification, and the rest of who are here, to say we need to put in a petition to the government for the decriminalization of marijuana. A man shouldn't have a spliff. Let me tell you this. I run an entity where I employ persons with government money. And one of the directives that I get is that I cannot employ somebody who have been charged. And most of the youths, when they do their police record, it is a ganja spliff they are charged for. And I can't employ them. I'm talking about hard-working youths. So I'm saying the decriminalization of marijuana is what I'm asking for. And I'm asking all who are here to join us and let we first get that first step. The last thing I would really like to speak on is to the family to say that this man is from Bluefields, Westmoreland, Belmont to be particular. And I'm warning everybody to say that you will not get the Peter Touch vibes to stay in Kingston. We're going to fight to the last breath for it to stay in Westmoreland, and more so in Bluefields, Westmoreland, right where he came and ride his unicycle, sit over KD's keg, eat the fish, and smoke his good marijuana. Westmoreland, where the best marijuana comes from.
I don't know, boy. Them have you on the spot, and you're not the government, but look like you're the government tonight. You know. But there were actually some good words that were said, and you made some very good points, and I think everyone should really lobby, just as you said, and petition for such a great cause, because you know, in Holland is one place you just walk around, you go into the supermarket and you pick the Colombian or the Jamaican, and it's right there, and you don't have a problem, you know. But it's something that, you know, Dr. Omar said we should all should do, and for him alone can't do it, and a next government minister alone can't do it, and I alone can't do it. It has to be a body together that petition for it. Okay? Any more questions? Somebody had asked me that they never knew of much of Sister Marley, and they were happy that she's here tonight to kind of share some of the experiences, because nobody right now in here, nobody knows the in-depth thing more so than her. And somebody said to me, boy, I wonder if she could come up and just tell me, you know, what really happened that night in 5 minutes, you know, so we can understand, because we hear so much different things. And I said to him, well, I'll ask her, but I know it's an emotional thing, because she has to go and relive some of those moments, and to relive moments like that when you have guns pointing down at you and two bullets blazing over your head, it's not an easy thing to recollect. Because 2 weeks ago I was in California, and Michael that was living at the house, he could open his dread and show me where the bullet bounced on his skull and came out back, you know what I mean, and he's living. And to relive that kind of moment, it's not an easy thing. But you know, the brethren over there had asked if Marley could just come up and do it in 5 minutes. I just give them a little, just what actually happened that night, you know, because people are still confused. You don't have to do it if you're gonna break down, you know, but it's just a request that was asked, because people are asking what really happened.
Just to answer the brother's question, I neglected to formally invite the Minister of Culture to this forum. So, you know, I mean, you can put it on me. I did not formally send out an invitation to the minister. So, you know, that's great. So, you know, that is all I can say. But, you know, certainly we'll do so in the future. Give thanks for the suggestion. Mr. Marley?
This is very important, and I'd love to get the attention of everyone. Don't turn your back to me, or just come out of the room. Right? I turn around if you do something else, but some question was asked, and they think that since Marlene is here, she could at least answer a few of them. It's very emotional, but I know about quite a few of them. But she prefer that I ask her the question and she answers them, because if she has to start going through them, it's going to be too emotional. So I would just go down step by step based on what I know and people who survived the night told me, and nobody can say it better than you. You were there, relived it, got shot in your head, and still here that you can talk about it. Now, one of the questions I would love to ask, and I was on tour when the fatal night happened, and I had spoken to Peter 3 days before that, and he told me that he wanted to do a show in Madison Square Garden by a certain time. I think it was somewhere later on down. And because he has the album No Nuclear War, I told him I was on tour with Third World at the time, right? Because both myself and one of his roadies, Flash, was on the road together. And he said, okay, he's going to wait until when we're finished. Then he went down to Jamaica. And when I heard the news, it was unbelievable. Because I'm going to tell you something ironic, you know, when the party forgot to work. 2 days before the incident, I called Marcia Griffiths at the time, and I said to her that, boy, you know, I was out here, we were in Texas, and I went to a promoter to make the settlement and pull a 45 at me, and I have to run left the money, you know, and she said, why? I said, I don't know. Then she called me back the next day and said, you know, something hopeless, I've got a vision, and this is the vision I got. I've got a vision that I saw Peter and Bob arguing like they were about to fight. And she said, whenever you dream about the living and the dead, it means something like a new death. Be careful out there, because see the man draw a gun at you, and you never can tell what is going to happen. And she tells me, be careful, be careful. I remember, you know, that time when the incident with the shooting up at Oak Road with Bob, she got a vision, and she faked sick and went to New York, that people thought she knew what was going to happen. So when she told me that, I didn't come out of the hotel room, but lo and below, it went the other way. Now, Sister Marlene, a lot of people were asking the question that the night of the fatal accident, I don't think that you call it accident, it was a situation where the people involved in the shooting were actually not strangers to the house, but actually been there before and had a good idea of the entire layout of the house, and were very close to Peter. Can you elaborate on the closeness of the so-called assassin?
The closeness was that people used to come to our house and ask us to help, and we always help, the type of person we are. Try to do what I could do to these people. And keep on coming back, right? So, what we notice is when them come, you just don't feel good about them. You know, like sometimes you feel a vibe against people, you start to pick up a vibe against one of them. And you know, you would have turned to Peter, I'm going to say, Peter, you know, say, I don't like the vibe, so I would have to pick up half of the person. You know, feel good. I use a man, keep him about that. That vision is, vision the whole company, King Roga. Tell it to Peter, Mr. Peter, take a big up, just have the problem. She'll read it all, and don't forget it. Let me tell Peter about the big up. Peter said, Marley, you know what I'm saying, I'm here on this. I'm here on this, man. The one who knew, somebody told you can't get enough. Yes, they can't tell me, they can't. You can't protect yourself alone. You need to get it. Live again, life. Hear what me say to people, it's like me not hear me. The man just let anybody see my soul. I'm not doing that can't work. Can't let anybody see my soul. You need a road, come here, Mr. Jeff. Come here, Mac. Come here. Alright.
Okay. So these people actually were friends of the family. Right? So to speak.
It's strange, you know. People that we are here. I'm only calling friends. I'm only want a friend where my vibe does. See a cup of you. Yeah. Every time you come home and just see a negative vibes. Some of them only have money. Let us only have people where we just have people.
Wow. Why did I take this part, you know? So to ask these questions, you know, I mean, they get too hot. Anyway, there are so many queries. No, the drummer, Santa, got shot in the shoulder, and he still carries the bullet until this very day, right? Michael, who I met out in California a few weeks ago, he showed me his head where the bullet went in and bounced out, and he survived. No, the fatality was Peter, Priyai, you got hit, Mama Joy got hit, and you all survived. Just briefly, right, you don't have to go into peace, just describe quickly what happened in that 5 minutes.
As a woman beside Peter Tosh, right? And everybody who are calling for Peter Tosh estate right now never raised their hand. Them time it was JLP government, and that time them say common law and I have no right. I was no common law. I was married to Peter Tosh in Nigeria. And even if I was common law, what right any government give right to take where? When me work hard for, I work for Peter Tosh now. Work for him. So everything invests in Peter Tosh. Where is mine? Where is my investment? I want my investment. Yes. Yes, I'm working on my broker.